We're done with relation algebra. That's all I have to say for relation algebra. And you're ready to do your homework too. Now, I give you a few examples. Just give you a feeling what homework 2 is about. Then we will move on to real work on a real database server, SQL. Okay? Now, let's look at some examples. I mean, you may wonder, okay, why I have to worry about this? You know, this is fine, it's interesting, but why it matters? You know, sounds like an interesting mind game, but so what? Well, the point is, these are important, right? If for example, if you are the university administrator, you want to find out which student has worked on all these projects, what do? You use DBNet. You need to understand DBNet to do a simple operation like that. Which student has worked on this set of projects? A simple question like that, that's precisely the logic expressed here. If you cannot understand this logic here, how are you supposed to do that? You may wonder, okay, those university staff, they probably don't understand division. Why they can still do it? Well, because that's because there are at least one guy like you who has done a nice form, a single button for them, so they click the button, they get the result. But at the end of the day, somebody needs to understand how to do that button. If everyone is gone who understands how to do that button, things will break, I guarantee you. We need to have at least some people to understand how to implement that button, which is what we are here for, right? Or if you think you want to do just click the button, of course, you don't have to understand this, right? Now, examples. Again, we use the reserve sailors and boats example. These are the instances we have. I'll show you some examples. Find the name of sailors with reserve boat 103. You want to find the name of sailor who reserved boat 103. Okay, so if your goal is to find the sailor IDs who have reserved boat 103, that's fairly simple. What do you do? Let found reserve where boat 103. And of course, if your goal is to find the sailor ID, you need to print out the sailor IDs. And using this particular instance, what you get is 58. But the question asks for the name of that sailor instead of simply the sailor ID values. Where the name information is available? Well, it's not available in the reserve table, so you do need to look at the other table, which is the sailors table. So how do you go from here to the sailors table? Let me ask one of you to answer that. You know, I can call the names I know, but I want to know some new friends. How about that? Yes, what's your name?
Shane.
Shane, okay.
You can join the result of that with the sailors table, natural
join. Natural join, fantastic, okay. Hold on a minute, let me ask you a further question. Let me write down the query first. Okay, when you do this natural join, what happens?
Then you're going to have the names of all the sailors who have at the zero flat boat. But you'll also have all the other columns. You'll have rating and age and SID. So if you just want their name, you need another projection.
Okay, so let me put the question the other way. What is the schema at this point, after the natural join? What is the schema of this?
SID, S name, rating, age.
Fantastic. Note that you have only one SID column. Even though you have one SID from here, another SID from here, but because you are doing a natural join, you keep only one copy of the common attribute. Fantastic. Excellent. And what does the instance look like in this case?
Which boat ID was it?
103. That's it, right? Because the instance of this, using our particular instance, is only 58. And you have three records from here, but only one of them match with this. So only this last record will survive the natural join. Fantastic. Curtis.
Could we join mind reserve and sale of first, then select, and then...
Yes, I will come to that point. Excellent point. I will talk about that in a minute. Let me finish this word. Right? We're not done yet. Because this is what? You need to find the name of the seller, right? This reminds me of one thing I have seen from many, many movies, right? The bad guys, you know, kick the good guy down to the floor and almost kill the good guy, but he or she didn't manage, you know, bother to do that last final trivial step, you know, all the hard work. And then 10 seconds later, we all know the story. The good guy has to win, right? I mean, otherwise, how can I be a movie, right? So the good guy will get back up and kill the bad guy, right? But the point is, we have done the hard work, but we haven't finished the job yet. Let's finish the job, which is... So make sure, I don't care whether it's the bad guy or good guy down the floor, make sure you finish it, okay, before you turn the back to the person. Okay, so you put out the seller name, you're done. Back to Curtis' comment. You could also do the same query in a different way, which is you know, I don't care who reserved which boat. I just want to find all the matching record between reserve and sailors, which gives me not only the sailor information, but all the boats and date they reserve a boat for. This gives me all the... Yes, question.
Sorry, is there going to be efficiency difference?
Excellent point. What's your name?
Alex.
Alex's question is, will there be an efficiency difference between... Obviously, yes. I will get to that point. So this will give you the sailor information and the reservation he or she has ever made. Now, you know, we say, okay, you know what, that's interesting, but I only care about 103. So what do? You do a selection on board 103. Then from here, you put that out your final answer, which is sailor name. That make sense? I mean, it does exactly the same thing as the first query does at the end of the day, but the way they do it is different. If we look at, take a closer look at what happens here, we're doing a natural jump between reserve and sailors. What's the schema of this? The schema of this is sailor ID, sailor name, rating, age, boat ID, and date. By the way, when we talk about schema, the order of the attributes in the schema doesn't really matter. It's a set, it's not an ordered set. Okay? What are the instance of this natural draw? The instance of this will be 22, Dustin, 7, 45, 101, October 10, 96. That's the first record. The second record will be 58, Rusty, 10, 35, 103, November 12, 96. Those will be the only two records in the instance of this natural draw. Why? Because you look at the cross product between the two, which gives you six records in total, all the possible matchings. But among those six, only two satisfy the requirement of natural draw, which is sailor ID value are the same. You keep those two, put that away, one of the sailor ID values, then you're done. That's what you get. Then you do a selection on that. Among those two records, the second record, which is 58, Rusty 10, 35, 103, November 12, 96, satisfies this query condition. So the first record will be removed, the second record will survive the selection, then you do the final projection, you got your sailor name. Now back to Alex's question, which is more efficient? Okay, what's your name?
Ahmed.
Ahmed. Ahmed said the left one is more efficient because you're reducing the number of comparison you have to do in the joint operation. Excellent. And clearly that's the case. Now, that goes back to my argument, the first statement I made regarding relational algebra, which is they are operational. I hope this example helps you understand what I mean by operational. Because not only relational algebra query tells you what you want, but in a way, it also tells you how you actually go about doing it. Right? As demonstrated in this example. So later on, shortly, we will start talking about SQL. SQL, on the other hand, for the most part, only tells you what you want. The operational part, which is how to execute a particular SQL query, is taken care of by the database engine automatically. And that process, which is translating from what you want to how to do it, to something that's operational, is achieved by using relational algebra representation inside a database engine. And we will have more discussion on that later on. But I will be clear on this. This is an adequate database class. I will not be able to talk about all these details regarding how that query optimization is done, which is translating what to an efficient operational plan inside the engine. If you're interested in that, take my grad level database class. Okay? The grad level database class basically discuss all those issues and your product. It's not about building a simple thing like TripAdvisor, which is what you're doing right now, which is building the Oracle database server itself, things like that. How to build an Oracle database server itself. Okay? So that's what you do in GradLab. Okay, that said, move on. Okay? First example. So we show two. You guys are very good, right? You figure out both solutions. Excellent. Okay? Now, fun name of Cedar who reserve a red color boat. Well, this basically expands a little bit more involved than the first example we have seen. Why? Because now you need the name information of sailors, which is from the sailors table. And you also need the color information of boat, which is not in sailors, nor it is in the reserve table. It is in the third table we have, which is the boat. So somehow you need to involve all three of them. Sounds complicated, but using natural knowledge, this is very simple. You do the binding of these three tables using natural knowledge. So sailors, natural knowledge with reserve, natural knowledge with boat. What I'll give you? That gave you the sailor information and all the reservation record he or she has made, and the detailed boat information on each of those reservation instances. I give you the combination of all such results in this three table natural knowledge. And once you have that, you can do a selection, right? Or you can do it more efficiently. The approach I mentioned is really this. Obviously, this is not the most efficient plan to do this, right? Obviously. This probably is the least efficient way to do this, which is you do the natural norm first, then you do this selection only at the end. This is probably the least efficient way to do this. Right? You want to do the filtering condition as early as possible to reduce, as Ahmad has mentioned, which is reduce the number of comparison you have to do in your query processing. So a better way of doing this is, why not you select the red color boat first, which is select out the color on both words, then you natural knowledge reserve, then you natural knowledge sailors, and put out the names. An even more efficient way to do it is to figure out the red color boat, but as soon as you know the red color boat, the name of the boat, the manufacturer of the boat, those are irrelevant to you anymore. All you care is boat ID at that point. So you figure out the red color boat, then immediately you narrow down to only the boat ID of those guys, because that's all you care. Use the boat ID, do a natural join with reserve on boat ID. But immediately you do that, you no longer care about the reservation date and things like that. You only care about the seal ID at that point. So you put out the seal ID after the natural join with reserve. Then using those seal IDs, you know that those are the seal IDs who have reserved, who have reserved a regular boat. Then only using those sailor IDs, you do a natural draw with sailors, you find the sailors you want, then you put out the names. Obviously, this will be the most efficient way of doing this query. Yes?
Could you add another projection to reservations in the more efficient solution?
Yes, that's right.
Before the natural join?
Yes, you can make it a little bit more efficient to do a projection here. What do you put that out, by the way?
Remove out. You just want to keep SID and boat ID.
Yes, you want to put that out both SID and boat ID. In order to do the natural join, you need to keep the boat ID. And in order to do the natural join with sailors, you need to keep the sailor ID information. Find sailors who reserve a red or green boat. So this is a little bit trickier than what we had before. But it's not that complicated, right? Because all you do is change the selection condition from color equal to red to color equal to red or color equal to green. That makes sense? Then the same query will carry. Not the same query will carry on. Here, I'm going to use this opportunity to introduce a renaming operator, using the renaming operator to simplify your query construction. So some queries can become fairly complicated, right? Like in this case, three table join. And if I were to change this query condition from this to color equal to red or color equal to green, I cannot even write this up on this single screen, right? So sometimes, for that matter, sometimes you want to simplify your query construction process a little bit by using the renaming operator. Here is how. So first, you select the red color or green color boat. Instead of taking that directly into your query construction, you rename that into a temporary relational instance, which is what I call temp boat, right here. Here, I'm not renaming any attribute. I only rename the output instance of this query. Once I have that, I can use temp boats to construct the remaining part of my query. So I can write temp boat, natural join reserve, natural join sailors. That's the same as you do the natural join of reserve and sailor with red or green color boats. That make sense?
So essentially, you're just creating a temporary table called temp boats that you're storing output of that in?
Yes, okay. That's what it is. Next, what about sailor who reserve a red and green boat? So here is a red or green boat. What about red and green boat? It's tempting, after we have seen this example, a tempting solution is to do what? Simply change all to and. Color equal to red and color equal to green. Is that right? No? Is that a correct solution for this problem? He said no. Why? Tell me. What's your name?
Josh.
Josh. Okay.
Because that's asking for boats that are both red and green.
So it would be not, right? There's no such boat. I mean, I'm talking about solid green and solid red. I'm not talking about the boat that half green, half red. I'm talking about, suppose each boat has only a single color on it, right? So if you do color equal to red and color equal to green, you will have no such boat. You end up with an empty instance at the output. Josh is right, okay? So how to do it? Well, yes. How do you do it? Well, what you want to do is find the red color boat, or temp red, green color boat, temp green. But in this case, I don't want to keep all the information about those boats. Sorry, what I'm doing here is I find the red color boat that I naturally don't reserve and put out the sail ID. I find the green color boat and naturally don't reserve, find out the sail IDs. I call them temp red and temp green. What do they give you respectively? Well, they give you the set of sailor IDs who have reserved a red color boat and who have reserved a green color boat, respectively. Then the guys who have reserved both of them is a simple intersection between the two. So I do intersection, I find the seed IDs who have reserved a red color vote and a green color vote. Then I use that set of seed IDs to do a natural drawing of sealers and put out the sealer names. Does that make sense to you? Okay, now find the name of sealers who reserve all votes. I'm not going to show you the answer. Let's do this together. Maybe I should switch back to PowerPoint because it has animations. Once I change to PDF, all the animation is gone. So I will consider switching back to PowerPoint next lecture. But now let's bear with me. I'm going to show you the question really quick. Then I'm going to come back because I don't want you to look at the solution. Right? So sailors will reserve our boats. The name of sailors reserve all boats. So how do you do this, Corey? So first of all, let me ask a simple question. No, I'm not going to ask you for the entire construction of the query, right? Just give me some rough idea which operator you're going to do this for. Oh, Michael, yeah, go ahead.
I'm curious if any division might work, so like if you did a projection on both, to see if vote ID and then do a division of the reserves.
Fantastic. You did more than what I have asked for, but very good answer. So I will write it out. Michael said, you wonder whether division might work. And then he said, I will put out all the vote IDs. Then I use reserve divide by that. That's what he said. And that should give me what I want. There's a subtle thing here though. Let me ask Michael, okay? What is the schema of this output? Remember, the schema of reserve is what?
So that's just going to print out the reservations between all boats and sailors, but you're not going to get the names, so you've got to use it for the join.
Okay, let's forget about the name for now. Let's say name is easy, right? Let's say I want the IDs, sailor IDs of sailors with all boats. What is the schema of this that you have just told me? Schema, not the instance. What is the schema of this? Can you tell me?
So isn't that just, it's all the IDs and the dates, right?
Yes. It's SID and date, right? By our discussion on division, right? All the X that match with, sorry, all the X, this together is X. So let me write this way, so it's super clear. So all the X that match from your Y, because this is your Y now, right? This whole thing is you, if you look at A divided by B, this whole thing now is your B. Now the both is now your B. This whole thing after the production is your B. So that your Y is simply old ID. So this is your X, seed ID and date. And what does it tell you then? What exactly this query does? Does it really give you the sailor who reserved all boats or something else? Yes?
Sailor who reserved all boats on one day.
Excellent. Sean?
Shane.
Okay. Sailors reserve all boats on the same day. So it's a subset of what you're looking for. Yes, these are the sailors who reserve all boats, but they're special. They reserve all boats on the same date. Why? Because the schema is this. So a given X value, when it matches with all the possible Ys, let's say you have N boats, these are all the possible boat ID values. When this X matches with all of them, they must have the same value on SID and date. How do you fix this problem?
Uh-huh. Can you just project the sailor ID for reserves?
Only sailor ID? Okay, if you do this projection, this no longer works. because what your A becomes is seller ID, your B becomes voter ID. B is not even, the schema of B is not even a subset of schema of A. You cannot even do the division.
Seller ID with voter ID.
Yes. For now that, now we are talking. Now we are talking. Now you get seller ID. When you X match with otherwise, that's a single seller ID value reserve all the both IDs. So it is tricky. It's not that simple, okay? But once you understand what's going on, they become simple too. So it's really a matter of whether you want to spend some time to think about it. Okay? Now, okay, let's go back to names. But once you have that, you know it's easy, right? What do you have? Well, how do you find the names? Well, you can do this natural drawing with sellers. And then finally, what do you do? Select the names, yes, right. By the way, when I do this natural drawing, is it necessary for you to do a projection of seller ID here? The answer is no, you don't have to, because by the end of the division, this whole thing, A is seller ID anyway. You don't have to do a projection anymore. If you do this projection, it doesn't save you any efficiency. Actually, it makes things worse, because you're introducing overhead now. So don't do this, okay? Final thing I want to throw it on the table is, what about if I do, simply do this? Can I do that? You ask me who reserve are both? Fine, I use reserve divided by both.
I think I'll still have the day in it, because the both still have the BID, that'll get divided, but...
Raj, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
That'll get divided, but the reserve will, let's just be the same problem we had earlier.
So you still have that problem that Michael, the answer has a limitation for, which is you still have day here, so it's not right. But even more serious concern is what? Is that the both the schema is what? There is another thing I forgot. I'm both adding color, whatever. There's another thing.
Name?
Okay. When you do reserve divided by both, it will be disallowed. Because the schema of both is not even a subset of schema reserve. You cannot possibly find one X from reserve that match with all such values and belong to reserve. Because reserve doesn't even have attributes like color and name. How can you possibly find X that match with all these values? They don't even exist over there.
Can we join reserves and both, then do this? And then divide by both.
Okay. I mean, theoretically you can, but why you want to do that? let me be careful in what I said. Okay. Can we really do it? Yes, you can do it. But then there's no point of doing that, right? Okay. Example of expressing division. Okay, this, okay, let me spend a little bit of time discussing this. Now, I'm gonna use this example as another value to reinforce your understanding on division, right? So we said we can express division using basic operators. And here is a run through of what this query looks like if you use basic operators. Ask somebody to help me here. So how about that person in the last row? Yes. What's your name? You're with the mic. Yes. What's your name?
Joel.
Louder?
Joel.
Joel? Can you tell me how to do this?
Just
pay attention. Okay. I know some of you are looking at your laptop. Yes, maybe you work really hard. You're asking questions, you're doing Google search. But if that Google search, whatever, a Facebook post doesn't help you understand the event, I guess this is more interesting. Okay? All right, so pay attention to this, okay? So, example of expressing dividend. What we said before is that you're gonna express dividend using the combination of basic operators. And what you do is you find, so this is my reserve, right? And this is my cost. So what I do, I purge that out where X is the schema of A minus schema of B, by the way. In this case, which is, what's X in this case? SID and, sorry, not both, SID and, if that's your A, if that's your A, this is your B, your X will be SID and date. Your X will be SID and date. Right? Does that make sense? If that's your A, that's your B, then your X is SID and date. But obviously that's not what we want, so we have to first put that away. So let me show you. I think I do have an animation. I don't have animation, so this is bad. So, okay, I'm going to reboot this into PowerPoint. Oh, maybe I can show PowerPoint from here as well. Let's try. Some of the display will mess up, but hopefully the animation will still be there. Maybe Google Doc. Okay, some of the animation are back. Cool. Some are messed up, as you see. But okay, let's try to do the division now. So, to express this division operator, right? So your X is bold ID in this case, given this particular setup. Does that make sense to you? Because I put out the serial ID and bold ID first, and I put out the bold ID from both, so my X is serial ID in this case. I put out the serial ID from A, which is from this table right here. And the only values are 22 and 58. You remove the duplicates. Does that make sense to you? Right? I cross with all the B's. By the way, all the B's, the B here is not this bold anymore. B is the projection on bold ID, which is 101, 102, 103, and 104. I do the cross product of them. What do I get? I got all the combination of which sailor reserve which bold. Of course, for only those sailors who have actually show up in the reserve table. If you don't even show up in the reserve table, I don't care. You cannot possibly reserve all boats. You don't even reserve a single boat. Right? So I only care about the sailor ID that does show up in the reserve table in the first place. So that's all such possible combinations. Do you follow me? And where we are now, we are at per dot of X of A, cross B, that's where we are at. Then what do? We minus away A. In this case, the reservation showing sailor ID and boat ID. Which sailor reserve which boat? You follow me? Which is the projection on these two columns. And in this case, we have one duplicate we will remove. Sailor 22, reserve boat 101 twice on different dates. But after I do the projection on sailor ID and boat ID, only one of those reservations will show up. That's why you see only 122 and 101 here. Does that make sense to you? No, not this. Only 122 and 101 here. Minus away that, what are they give you? That give you the reservation on certain boat that was not made by those sailors. meaning those are the sailors who have not reserved a boat. In this case, these are the record, meaning 58, sailor 58 has not reserved this boat. But I don't really care which boat you haven't reserved, I only care the fact that you haven't reserved all the boats. So I further out this, which is 58. Then I use all the sailor ID minus away this. I got my answer 22. You follow me? Now I ask one final question. What happens if we do this? Instead of product our sailor ID from that A. A is my sailor ID and boat ID from the reserve table. Instead of doing that on top, I will do this. What happens now? Can someone tell me? So this part stays exactly the same, which is the sailor ID who hasn't reserved all the boats. So what happens now? If I product sailor ID from sailors minus with this, what does it give me? What's your name? I didn't play yourself.
Andrew.
And you, go ahead.
It's gonna include all the sailors who haven't worked on the table at all.
And?
In addition to the correct one.
Yes, Andrew said, basically, let me repeat what he said. This will give you the sailor IDs who has reserved our boat, obviously. Because the sailor IDs from the reserve table must be a subset of all sailor IDs. So those guys are still there. Plus, those sailors who has never reserved any boat. Because if you have never reserved any boat, you're not going to show up here. So what's here? Here are the sailors who has reserved some boats, but who haven't reserved all boats. That's what's here. Sailor IDs who have reserved some boats, but haven't reserved all boats. That's your sailor ID here. And when you use all the possible sailor ID minus with that, what you get? You got sailor ID who reserved all the boats and who haven't reserved any boat at all. Excellent. Okay. Summary, you can read the summary itself. Okay. Let's move on to the next part. Okay, before I move on to the next part, which is SQL, I will show you how to connect to our database server. You will start practicing queries against the database server. Okay? There are two ways of making the connections. Let me first see whether I have workbench. Okay, I don't have workbench here, so I will go ahead. I will show you the download process for that. If you are on a Mac, or MySQL. I think I have a MySQL. So if you have a Mac or a Ubuntu system like Linux, right? You can download a MySQL client program, which is a command line program, which is you can install on your own computer or you can go to any GitLab machines. Example. Okay? That's my Git account. And they have MySQL there as well. So it's already installed. Okay? You can do it either on Git machine or on your own machine after you install the MySQL client program. Okay? If you are about to just apt-get MySQL client, you will get it. Right? Now, once you have this installed, you type this. By the way, you can take note, but I will make an announcement on Canvas with all the detailed instructions how to do this. So you can take note, or you don't have to take notes if you don't want to. Okay? The server name is Georgia. I didn't get this name by myself. The KitLab assigned this to me. And there was this is a real story, right? So I was in Florida when I was begin my faculty career. Florida, I'm in the north part of Florida, so it's border with a state called Georgia. Right? And that's around the time the Russians invaded Georgia, the country Georgia. Remember? That's which year was it, like 2008 or 2009. Now, we listen to this news radio. Then this lady from Georgia called in, said, I heard the news, Georgia invaded us. What happened? I mean, that's supposed to be a joke, okay? I don't know if you realize this or not. Anyway, that's a real story. Okay? I'm not making this up. So the server name is georgia.engine.utah.edu-h stands for hostname. Dash u is username. So each of you will have two user accounts. Each of you has two user accounts. I'm going to talk about the first user account here. The first user account, the username is cs5530. And this is a class-wide user account, meaning all of you will share this account with the same password. And why that's the case? Because there are some class-wide databases. There's one database or two such databases that I have populated data with, and I want you to practice your queries and do your upcoming homework 3 on that database. And this account has read-only access on that database. So you will share this account and access those two common class-wide databases. Does that make sense to you? And I will show you how to do that. Dash P means this account, in order to access the database, does require a password. And finally, you simply supply the name of the database you want to connect to, because Georgia.engine.utah.edu, that's your database server, but on that database server, you may have multiple databases. And in each database, you may have multiple tables. So you need to specify which database you are connecting to, unless you are a super user, you can connect to any database there. Right? So you need to supply a database name. In this case, this is one of the common databases all of you will have access to. That makes sense to you? Now it asks the password. Password is the same as the password you use to get your homework solution. Hopefully you know. If you don't know, it means you haven't looked at homework 1 solution, which is not a good sign, by the way. Okay, so that's the same password you use for that. Once you are connected, there are a few common commands you can play with. Show tables, that will give you the list of tables in this database. And you can use describe, followed by a table name, that give you the schema information of that table. So maybe I should turn the light off. Okay? And you can execute simple queries, right? And select. Okay, this gives you the data in that table. Like I said, this account has only read-only access to this database. If you try to make changes to this database, let's do that. So for example, you don't like this class, you hate this class. You want to make sure no other student can take this. Okay? Guess what? You cannot. Lucky or not, you have to take it. So it will be redacted. What happened if you do want to delete this database? So you quit. Now I'm going to log in using my account. And obviously I'm a super user, I set up the server myself. My password, I won't tell you. And I show databases. Remember the databases you saw just now? Okay. I forgot to show you one thing. So let me quit this. If you try to check the databases you have, you see This database you're connected to, and DBLP, that's another database you can have access to using this account. And to switch to another database, you simply use the command use. And that will connect you to the other database you have access to. Okay? And this is a slightly larger table. For example, if I do, this is small, so let me see. So this is a slightly larger table, but not so much larger, maybe only 16 million entries, or 1.6 million entries. Small table, right? Very small. Okay. Now let me connect using my account. So first thing I'm gonna show is so you see now I can see these many databases. CS5530DB01 to DB all the way to DB140. Because we have 140 students, I have set up a single database for each of you. And of course, you cannot use that class-wide database account I showed you just now, CS5530, to access those databases. You cannot even see them. Okay? So how do you access your own database? I will talk about that in a minute. Let me demonstrate one thing though. I'm a super user, so I can access any database. So I will access this database. Now I see the same thing. I can do this. And I can do this. Why I can do this? Well, not that I don't want you to take my class, you know, I just want to take time off. I don't want to teach it. So, of course, I'm allowed to delete, right? Okay, I can delete. You cannot delete, I can delete. Okay? The other thing keep in mind, now in addition to this, we have log in place. So every command you type over there is log. So if you try to do something funny, you know, I can go back and check the log. But go ahead and try it. Security is set up, so you cannot do much anyway. Okay, now that's that. So you understand how to access this class-wide database using this common class account. What about those databases that you want to access on your own for your project? You will email one of our TAs. Send an email to any one of them, okay? They will assign you a database for your product. And that database, you have full access control, meaning you can do selection, you can do deletion, insertion, update, create table, you can do anything. And the naming convention is, so your username will be CS5530U, stands for username, X, X is the number. And your database will be CS5530DBX, where X starts from 01 instead of 1. So it's really, I was trying to make alignment nice. That was when we only have less than 100 students. So it's 01 instead of 001. Now we have 140 students. I forgot to change my script. So it's still with 01. Right? So the alignment is off a little bit, but that's okay. So 01, 02, all the way to 140. So you will get one of such X value, remember that? And that will be username, that will be your database, and password you will get it from the TA. When you send the request to the TA, asking for your database, and your user account, and your password, remember to submit three things. Your UID, your name, first name, last name, and the email address you check regularly. UID, full name, first name, last name, then an email address you use regularly. Okay? That's for this part. I run out of time. Next lecture, at the beginning, I will show you quickly. Some of you may not like to access a database server using a command line, like interface. You prefer to have a GUI interface. On Monday, I will show you how to do that using MySQL Workbench. See you on Monday. Assignment 2 is out. It's due on Wednesday, 1 week from now. Start working on it.